Today we're going to create this animation using a bunch of techniques. Some interesting masking, offsetting motion, animating colors, timing, and super soft gradients. And if you're like me, you'll find them really useful in a ton of different types of projects and situations. I designed this in Illustrator, separated the letters onto their own layers, and imported them into After Effects. And you can download the final project file as well down in the description. We're going to approach this animation by animating one letter and one beam, getting those the way we like it, and then copying that to the other layers. So it might start slow, but it all comes together at the end faster than you might expect. First, let's create our beam, which will introduce our first letter, M. We'll grab our rectangle tool, and we're just going to click and drag the approximate shape of our beam, because we're going to dive deep into the settings and adjust its size specifically to be the exact width of the M. Now, we could toggle down the shape layer, the contents, the rectangle path to get to the size. But if they're all closed and we want to open everything, we can just hold Ctrl or Command and click the arrow here, and that reveals every single property. And size is right at the top. So command clicking an arrow opens everything. That is a very useful shortcut if you're digging for a property that's buried deep, deep down there. So let's unlink the width and height. And we want this to be the full height of the comp. So let's make that 1080. And for the width, we'll make that 110. And let's place the shape layer underneath our M and make sure that lines up. And there we go. It's the exact width of our M. And how could I possibly know the width? Well, earlier in Illustrator, I measured it. Now let's make sure it lines up with the top and the bottom of the comp, and let's name it beam and color it green, because we always label our layers. And let's change the fill to a linear gradient fill. We can also cycle through the fill options by holding Alt and clicking the fill color here. Now to set the direction of the gradient, we want to grab these two handles and drag each of them to different ends of our shape. And we can click on the box next to fill to bring up our gradient editor. The color that's currently black, let's eyedrop a dark green color. And then let's eyedrop the other colors to make a gradient something like this. There. Now to get it to fade off as we go towards the top, we're going to add a mask. So with this layer selected, we're going to grab our rectangle tool, and we're going to make sure that we select not tool creates shapes, not that, but tool creates masks. And we're going to click and drag at around the bottom half, bottom two thirds of our beam. And I'm extending the mask pretty far away from all of the other edges. Then we want to hit F on our keyboard, which will bring up the mask feather. And let's increase that until we get a nice soft gradient fading off at the top. And let's drag that up a fair bit. Let's go all the way up to 700. And we can maybe drag our mask down a little bit. I'm gonna hit V on my keyboard to bring up my arrow selection tool. And then just drag that down a little touch there. And this is why we left a big gap on the outsides, on the other sides. Because if we make it too close to our beam, it's going to fade out on the sides as well. And we don't want that. So now let's animate our beam coming on. And we can do that with its scale. So let's bring up its scale with S on our keyboard. And let's unlink the width and the height. So we can just animate the scale on the Y axis and it will grow and shrink. But to make it grow and shrink from the bottom of the comp, we are going to need to adjust the anchor point of the shape layer, which is currently right in the middle. So let's grab our anchor point tool, select it and drag it down to the bottom. Now you do want to make sure snapping is selected because that will make it much easier. And let's keyframe its scale around 1.5 seconds in. That's when it will be at its maximum height. And then at the start, we're going to drag that down to 0. There, so now our beam is growing, but we can make that animation much more interesting. We'll select those keyframes, hit F9 on our keyboard to easy ease them. And then let's tweak those in the graph editor. At the very start, we're going to move this handle up to get a really sharp, severe ease, so it really accelerates in, just really bursts out of there. And then make it really ease into its final position. There, that's looking good. Let's get out of the graph editor, and we need to animate our beam disappearing. Now we could animate its scale going down again, but that's no fun. And if we use another property, it gives us more freedom to change the timings later. That is much, much easier. So what other properties of this layer could we animate to get it to reveal off? We could animate the mask path moving downwards. We could animate the position of this layer going off screen as well. But what we're going to do is animate its opacity. So let's open that up with T on our keyboard. And around half a second in, let's keyframe its opacity there at 100%. And then I'm going to hit U on my keyboard to bring up all the other keyframes and where they finish as well, 1.5 seconds. Let's drag the opacity down to 0. So it animates up from the bottom, and as it almost reaches the top, it starts to fade away. And because the animation on and off are on separate dimensions, it's much easier for us to move these about and see if we prefer it animating off slower or maybe animating off much sooner. But let's keep it where it was before. We'll add a bit of easing with F9 on the keyboard and just a tiny bit of tweaking in the graph editor. And we've got a nice fade out. Now for some extra pizzazz, let's duplicate this beam layer with Control or Command D. And we're going to expand it a little bit, make it a bit wider. So let's open up its size property and increase that to 150, which is wide enough to exactly touch the letter next to it. And so this sort of secondary beam is not so intense. Let's turn its opacity down to 70% when it's at its maximum. So now we just need that glow at the very bottom of our beam. And for that, I'm going to show you another gradient technique just using feathered masks. So let's grab our rectangle tool. This time we want it to have a solid fill. Let's select a dark green color and draw a big shape down the bottom of our beam. Then we want to select our ellipse tool from the toolbar up here and make sure we have tool crate mask selected. And then we want to draw roughly an ellipse down the bottom of that beam. We can open up feather with F again on our keyboard and increase that to get a nice soft gradient. Let's go up to 400, which is why we made our shape layer nice and big in the first place, so we don't run into the edge of the shape. And then to adjust this shape slightly, I'm going to grab the pen tool, click the top point of our ellipse here, and just drag that up a touch. And to adjust these handles, I'm just going to drag them down, and to separate their sort of connectiveness across the point, I'm going to hold Alt Option, and then we can move each one individually. Let's just have them point down a little bit so it gets a little narrower and almost glows up our beam a tiny bit. Now we need to add some keyframes for this glow to animate on and off. Again, we'll do that with opacity, 0 at the start, then 100, then back to 0. The default Easy E should work for this too, and let's call that glow to separate it a bit in the timeline too. Let's also drag that below our beam layers, and I think we want our glow to animate a little sooner than our beam. So let's select our beam layers and just drag them across so they start half a second later. So then we see the glow coming up from underneath very shortly before we have that beam explode up out of the bottom of the screen. Now we do need more colors for this glow. So let's duplicate this glow layer, again, Control or Command D, and we're gonna change its fill color to a medium green. And we're gonna make this glow a little tighter to the center of our beam. So let's open up feather again with F on the keyboard. Let's drag this down to around 200. And then I'm gonna double click to select the mask and then drag it down closer to the center. And then let's do that once more, duplicating it again, selecting the very lightest color green for the fill, reducing the feather, this time down to 100, and make it even tighter to our beam. Now, depending on your settings, you might notice a fair bit of banding happening, where the color is kind of separated into these big chunky stripes. And the best way we can solve that is to change our bit depth. It's currently 8, so let's select that over here. Change it to 16 bits per channel. Now After Effects is working with more colors, and the gradient is nice and soft and smooth. Now, I just love the kind of soft gradients you can get with this effect, and it is really versatile too, because we can adjust each of these masks and the amount of feathering as well, and we can decide which colors are melting into one another. Now, let's take a look at all of their opacity keyframes. And to make this a bit more interesting, let's have the lighter colors start to animate on a little later and then fade off a little sooner. It's a small touch, but I definitely think it improves the effect and makes it a little more interesting than just a simple fade on and fade off. And there, our beam is done. Now let's select all of those layers and pre-comp them with Shift Control or Command C, and let's call that beam. Now for the type animation, and let's animate our M first. Then we're going to copy its animation to the other letters. But to make that easier, we need the anchor points of each of these letters to be in the same place, at least vertically, at the same height. And because each letter is a different height, the anchor points are in different places. So let's grab our anchor point tool and drag the anchor point of each letter to the baseline. So they are all at the same height. Again, make sure snapping is on to make this easier. Now to the M, and we can hide all of the others for now, so we're just focusing on what we need. And we're animating its position, so let's open that up with P on the keyboard, and we are going to right-click that and separate dimensions. We are only animating it vertically, so we do not need the X-axis confusing us when we get into the graph editor. And let's have our M layer start on the very first frame that our beam appears, which is frame 7. And now it's already kind of looking like our M is appearing with that beam, but we're going to exaggerate that with this position animation. So at around 1 second, I think, let's keyframe its position. That will be its final position where it will rest. And then we do want it to have a little bit of a bounce. So a little bit earlier, we're going to keyframe that same position. And then at the very start, let's move it down a little over the height of the M itself. There, now our M is raising up with the beam, but we need to tweak that a bit in the graph editor. So let's select these keyframes, hit F9, and let's go into the graph editor. Now we are in the value graph editor, which for me is way more intuitive for dealing with this kind of animations. Some people do prefer the speed graph though. I'll make some more room for this graph here. Let's zoom in a bit more. And first we're going to adjust it to be pretty fast at the start. And in this middle keyframe, Let's move it down in the graph editor, which moves that amp up a little bit. So it's going to have a little bounce. There, something like that, I think is working well. Now our M is done, so let's apply that to all the other letters. So we can turn them all back on. And we're going to copy these keyframes, with just Control C, select all the other layers, and at the very start, paste them as well. So now they all have that bounce animation. The tittle, the dot on our eye, is still attached to the baseline though. So I'm going to open up its position keyframes and just move that back up above the eye. There. Now let's drag each of these letters forward or backwards two frames in the timeline. And I'm kind of ping-ponging between the left and right. So it kind of goes back and forth until the last letter is I. And that is because I'm going to do something a little bit interesting with the tittle. But first, more beams. And this is where it gets really fun. We are going to duplicate our beam comp. And we are just going to drag that duplicate over to the next letter that animates in, which is the O. And because we measured earlier, lining it up exactly flush with the next letter. There, two beams down, and we actually want our beams above the letters, so let's drag those up as well, and that gives just a tiny gradient as we see through the beam and it colors our letters underneath. And of course we need to offset that beam two frames as well, and let's do that for each of the letters. There, now we're getting close. And one thing I have noticed, which I didn't pick up on earlier, is the top of our beam ends with a straight line, not a nice soft gradient like we want. So let's go back into our beam pre-comp, and that's the benefit of having this pre-comp, is we can go and make subtle adjustments inside here. And that, I believe, is to do with our mask here and the amount of feathering. So let's just hide the outside beam and adjust this first one. If we can drag this down a little, we can even reduce the feathering to maybe 500, just so now we get a nice soft gradient towards the top and we don't get that harsh line that was there before. And let's do that for our outside beam as well. There, back to the main comp, and that's looking much better. Now we're getting very close. There are two last small details. One is some animation on the tittle, the top of the eye that we have here. And I think we want to delay that a little bit, so it is the last thing to animate. So let's open up its position properties, and let's just go into the graph editor. And we're just going to move its last keyframe back a little bit and tweak the easing a touch. So now it just animates a little bit slower and maybe a little bit higher than the other letters as well. There we are. That's definitely the last thing we see now. And let's add a rotation animation to it too. Bring that up with R on our keyboard and rotate it at 90 degrees. So it ends up looking the same anyway. There we go. Definitely liking the look of that. And the last thing I want to add is a bit of a just flashing color animation to each of the letters as they're beamed on. So let's pick a letter to start. Let's pick our end this time at the very end. And we're going to add a fill effect to this layer. And let's eyedrop that fill effect to the dark green, and we're gonna add a keyframe to its color. So at the very start of its layer, it is gonna be that dark green. Then when it's at its max position, let's change it to the lighter green. And then when it rests, back to the dark green again. And let's easy ease those. So now the end has a very slight flash of color as it raises up. Again, pretty subtle, but I think it all works together and adds to make it just generally more interesting than just some lights fading on. So to copy that to all of our other layers, let's select the very start of this layer, select that fill effect, copy it, and then just Control V, paste it onto all of our other layers, except the dot of the eye, because that's a different color. And we're gonna make sure the playhead is at the very start of each of these layers. That way it pastes the keyframes in the same position too. Well, in relation to the start of each layer. So then they all now have a little subtle flash on as they enter. And that's the last thing we're doing that needs our color, so we can hide our palette layer. And there we have it, a whole bunch of techniques that come together to make a pretty neat glowy text reveal. Now I created this originally on stream as part of a 1 hour challenge with the students from my Master Motion Design course. They made some awesome animations in that time frame too. Here are some of theirs.
It needs
more money, more drugs, more rock and roll.
No, it needs motion.
And if you'd like to learn more ways to animate type in After Effects, I've got just the video for you. Thanks for watching. I'll see you there.